Hello everyone, let's learn about urea cycle today. At the end of the session, students shall be able to describe urea cycle with its energetics, regulation and significance. The associated disorders will be discussed in the next video. Before discussing urea cycle proper, let's first quickly revise various metabolic reactions that occur in the metabolism of amino group of amino acids, which eventually release amino group in the form of ammonium ion from amino acids. So that metabolism of amino group of amino acid begins with the transamination reaction, where transfer of amino group occurs from amino acid to keto acid. And there is formation of glutamate, and in this reaction transaminases catalyze this reaction, and PLP, that is pyridoxal phosphate, is the coenzyme here. So amino group from amino acid is collected in the glutamate. Now what happens to this glutamate? Transamination is followed by the process deamination, which means removal of amino group from this glutamate. And this process occurs in the mitochondria by this mitochondrial enzyme glutamate dehydrogenase. It requires either NAD or NADP, and then glutamate is converted into alpha ketoglutarate and the ammonia is released. Now this ammonia which is released in the form of ammonium ion has multiple fates, and the important fates are synthesis of glutamate, glutamine or urea, or it can be utilized in the formation of various compounds like purines, pyrimidines, aspargine and various amino sugars, etc. Then this deamination is followed by transport of ammonia in the form of glutamine. So this ammonium ion, which is released by deamination, it combines with glutamate by the action of enzyme glutamine synthase. So there is formation of glutamine. And most of the ammonia that is transported and stored in the form of this glutamine. Next, this glutamine is catalyzed by the enzyme glutamine synthase in the liver, and there is release of ammonium ion and glutamate. So this ammonium ion can directly be derived from this oxidative deamination. So we get now free ammonium ion, and as this free ammonium ion, they are toxic. So that has to be converted into non-toxic compound, that is urea. So the next is urea cycle. So this ammonium ion, they are converted into urea by various metabolic reactions called as urea cycle, and this process occurs in the liver. Urea is synthesized in the urea cycle. And this is the structure of urea. This urea has two nitrogen atoms. One nitrogen atom is derived from free ammonium ion and other from the amino acid aspartate. Carbon atom, it is supplied by bicarbonate ions, which is hydrated version of carbon dioxide. So formation of urea requires carbon dioxide, ammonium ion and aspartate. Urea is the end product of protein metabolism or amino acid metabolism. This urea is synthesized in the liver, and it accounts for 80 to 90% of nitrogen containing substances in the urine. It is the normal constituent of urine. And human beings excrete about 10 kg of urea per year. Estimation of blood urea is used as a kidney function test for assessment of kidney dysfunction. Urea cycle is the cyclic process, and it is the first metabolic cycle to be discovered even before the TCA cycle. And this urea cycle was first proposed by Hans Krebs and Kurt Hanslet in 1932. That's why it is also called as Krebs-Hanslet cycle. As ornithine is also involved in this cycle, it is also called as ornithine cycle. Urea cycle occurs in the liver. It has 5 reactions and 5 enzymes. First 2 reactions occur in the mitochondria and 3 reactions occur in the cytosol. This is schematic representation of a cell. It has mitochondria and cytosol. So first two reactions occur in the mitochondria, because first two enzymes are located in the mitochondria and three enzymes are located in the cytosol. So which is the first reaction? That is synthesis of carbamoyl phosphate by the action of enzyme carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1. Second reaction is synthesis of citrulline by enzyme ornithine transcarbamoylase. Then other three reactions occur in the cytosol. Third reaction is the synthesis of arginosuccinate by the action of enzyme arginosuccinate synthetase. Fourth reaction is cleavage of arginosuccinate or formation of arginine by enzyme arginosuccinase. And fifth reaction is cleavage of arginine to form ornithine and urea by the action of enzyme arginase. Why the formation of urea occurs only in the liver? Because this enzyme arginase, it is exclusively present only in the liver. First reaction of urea cycle is synthesis of carbamoyl phosphate. Ammonium ion and carbon dioxide are the two starting molecules leading to urea synthesis. And the major bulk of this ammonium ion is derived from breakdown of amino acid by transdeamination. Some amount of ammonia is obtained from bacterial oxidation of amino acids in the intestine, reaching the liver via portal vein. But whatever is the source, this ammonium ion, they condense with carbon dioxide to form carbamoyl phosphate. And this carbon dioxide is derived from the cellular respiration. This reaction is catalyzed by mitochondrial enzyme carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, and two ATPs are required in this reaction. One ATP activates bicarbonate and the other supplies phosphate group of carbamoyl phosphate. Then this consumption of two ATP in this process makes this reaction irreversible, and this reaction is rate limiting step of the urea cycle, and this is allosterically regulated. This carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, which is also called as CPS1, this is absolutely dependent on N-acetylglutamate for its activity, and it is allosterically regulated by this N-acetylglutamate. So this is the first reaction, that is synthesis of carbamoyl phosphate. The second step of urea cycle is synthesis of citrulline, and this step occurs in mitochondria. For this step, ornithine is required, but this ornithine is present in the cytosol and it has to be transported in the mitochondria by ornithine citrulline transporter. Once it enters the mitochondria, the carbamoyl group from carbamoyl phosphate is transferred to ornithine to form citrulline, and this reaction is catalyzed by enzyme ornithine transcarbamoylase. Then after this reaction is over, further reactions occur in cytosol, and for that citrulline has to be transported in the cytosol. And both ornithine and citrulline, they are transported across mitochondria and cytosol by ornithine citrulline transporters. Both this amino acid, ornithine and citrulline, they are not normally present in the protein structure because of lack of genetic code. Third reaction of urea cycle is synthesis of arginosuccinate. It occurs in cytosol. In this reaction, aspartate combines with citrulline to form arginosuccinate. This reaction is catalyzed by enzyme arginosuccinate synthetase, and this aspartate is derived from transamination reaction, and this reaction requires ATP. ATP is cleaved into AMP and pyrophosphate. Pyrophosphate is further broken down into two molecules of inorganic phosphate. In this way, two high energy bonds are required in this reaction. So it is assumed that the conversion of citrulline to arginosuccinate requires two molecules of ATP. And the second nitrogen atom of urea is derived from aspartate, and the first one is from ammonia. Fourth reaction is synthesis of arginine. In this reaction, this arginosuccinate, it is cleaved by action of enzyme arginosuccinase to form arginine. The nitrogen atom, which is derived from aspartate, it is retained in this arginine, and remaining carbon skeleton of aspartate is removed as fumarate. And this urea cycle is linked to Krebs cycle through this fumarate. So this is the fourth reaction, which is catalyzed by arginosuccinase. The fifth reaction is synthesis of urea from arginine, and there is regeneration of ornithine. This reaction takes place in cytosol. So in this reaction, the arginine, which is formed in the fourth step, is now acted upon by enzyme arginase to form urea, and in this reaction ornithine is regenerated, which again gets transported in the mitochondria for second reaction, and again the cycle continues. So the ornithine, which is first utilized in the second reaction to form citrulline, is again regenerated in this fifth reaction. This formation of urea, it occurs only in liver, because this enzyme arginase, it is not present in the kidney and intestine. It is only present in the liver. In all other cells, synthesis of arginine can occur, but formation of urea requires enzyme arginase, which is exclusively or mostly present in the liver, and that's why urea synthesis occurs in the liver. Now, what happens to this urea? The urea which is produced in the liver, it is transported in the blood to the kidneys, and where it is excreted through urine. And some amount of urea, it reaches to intestine, where it is degraded to ammonia and carbon dioxide by the enzyme urease of bacteria, which are present in stomach and intestine. And the ammonia thus produced is usually lost in the feces. And the ammonia produced by the action of urease can combine with protons in the gastric fluid to form ammonium ion. And this reduces the concentration of proton and therefore makes the pH slightly alkaline. So this is the fate of urea that is formed in the urea cycle. Now let's see how urea cycle is linked with TCA cycle or Krebs cycle. And together this urea cycle and Krebs cycle are called as Krebs bicycle or urea bicycle. The fumarate, which is formed in the fourth step of urea cycle by the action of enzyme arginosuccinase. So this fumarate is linked to the TCA cycle. This fumarate, it is converted into malate by the action of enzyme fumarase, and then this malate is converted to oxaloacetate by the action of enzyme malate dehydrogenase. Both these reactions are similar to the reactions of TCA cycle. However, the enzymes fumarase and malate dehydrogenase can also be present in the cytosol, and they are also present in the mitochondria as a part of TCA cycle. So oxaloacetate can be formed from this fumarate in cytosol. The second fate is that malate can be transported in the mitochondria and converted into oxaloacetate and becomes the part of TCA cycle. And that's how the fumarate is linked to this TCA cycle. Now the carbon dioxide, which is generated in this TCA cycle, is utilized in the first reaction, that is formation of carbamoyl phosphate from ammonia and carbon dioxide. The oxaloacetate, which is intermediate of TCA cycle, is utilized to form aspartate, which is required for the third reaction, that is conversion of citrulline to arginosuccinate, and this aspartate is a donor of second nitrogen of urea. And this aspartate is derived from this oxaloacetate by transamination reaction. So indirectly we can say that the second nitrogen atom, which is derived from this aspartate, is actually, it is derived from this glutamate, which is formed in this transamination reaction. The another fate of oxaloacetate, it can be utilized in the gluconeogenesis, and that's how amino acid catabolism is directly coupled to the energy production. So this is urea bicycle or Krebs bicycle. How many ATPs are required in the urea cycle? In the first reaction, 2 ATPs are required to form this carbamoyl phosphate from carbon dioxide and ammonium ion. And in the third reaction, ATP is converted or cleaved to AMP and pyrophosphate, which is further cleaved to two molecules of inorganic phosphate, and this is equivalent to utilization of two high energy phosphate bonds. So in total, we can say that 4 ATP molecules are consumed in the synthesis of each molecule of urea. But as this fumarate, which is formed in the fourth reaction, it is linked to the TCA cycle, which is converted into malate by the action of fumarate, and later malate is converted to oxaloacetate by malate dehydrogenase, which is a part of TCA cycle. So in this reaction, NAD plus is reduced to NADH, and one molecule of NADH is equivalent to 2.5 ATP. So 4 ATPs are consumed, but 2.5 ATPs are formed in the conversion of malate to oxaloacetate. So the net ATP consumed in the urea cycle is 4 minus 2.5, which is equivalent to 1.5 ATP. What is the significance of urea cycle? Urea cycle is required for detoxification of ammonia, which is toxic product, and that's why it has to be converted into less toxic product, that is urea, and that's how it is involved in the detoxification of ammonia. It not only detoxifies ammonia, it also disposes of other waste product, that is bicarbonate, and it helps in the regulation of blood pH, which depends upon the ratio of dissolved carbon dioxide, that is the ratio of carbonic acid to bicarbonate. And this urea cycle is involved in the biosynthesis of arginine, which is produced in the fourth reaction, and this arginine is very essential compound which is required for the synthesis of creatine, along with other two important amino acid, glycine and methionine, and it is also important for synthesis of this nitric oxide. Ornithine, which is produced in the urea cycle, it is the precursor of various polyamines like putrescine, spermidine and proline. Carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1 is the allosteric enzyme of urea cycle, and it is also called as pacemaker enzyme, and this enzyme is responsible for formation of carbamoyl phosphate from ammonia and carbon dioxide in the first step of urea cycle. And this carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, it is allosterically regulated by N-acetylglutamate. This N-acetylglutamate, it is formed from glutamate and acetyl-CoA. So whenever there is increased transamination, there is more formation of glutamate, and it leads to formation of N-acetylglutamate by the action of enzyme acetylglutamate synthase. And this acetylglutamate synthase is activated by arginine, high protein diet and in conditions of starvation. So whenever increased proteins are taken in the diet, those carbon skeleton of those proteins are utilized for energy purpose, and the amino groups, they are converted into urea and later on excreted through urine. Likewise, in case of starvation, there is more breakdown of protein to form amino acids. The carbon skeleton of those amino acids are utilized for energy purpose, and the amino group, they undergo the transamination reaction, and there is formation and release of ammonia, which is toxic, and it is converted into urea through urea cycle and later excreted through urine. So that is how urea cycle is regulated by allosteric mechanism, by this activating allosteric regulatory enzyme carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, and through this N-acetylglutamate. Other than carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, there is one more enzyme, carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 2. And the difference between these two enzymes is most commonly asked in Viva or in multiple choice questions. So let's see what is the difference between CPS 1 and CPS 2. So this carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, this enzyme is involved in the urea synthesis, while CPS 2, it is involved in the pyrimidine synthesis. CPS1 is present in the mitochondria, whereas CPS2 is present in the cytosol. N-acetylglutamate is required for this activity of CPS1, and it is a cofactor for that, but no such cofactor is required for activity of CPS2. In case of CPS1, ammonia is a nitrogen donor, but in case of CPS2, glutamine is nitrogen donor. There is no inhibitor of this CPS1, while in case of CPS2, cytidine triphosphate is the inhibitor. So these are the various differences between CPS1 and CPS2. Now it's time to discuss some MCQs to revise today's topic. So the first MCQ is, urea is synthesized in the, options are brain, kidney, muscle and liver. So we know that urea is synthesized in the liver. So correct option is option D, that is liver. Question 2. The regulatory enzyme of urea cycle is CPS1, CPS2, arginase or ornithine transcarbamoylase. And the regulatory enzyme of urea cycle is carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1. So the answer is option 1, that is CPS1. Third question is, N-acetylglutamate is allosteric activator of arginase, arginosuccinase, CPS1 or CPS2. So we know that CPS1 is regulatory enzyme of urea cycle and it is regulated by allosteric mechanism, and N-acetylglutamate is the allosteric activator of this enzyme, that is CPS1. So the answer is C. Two nitrogen atoms of urea are contributed by fumarate aspartate, aspartate oxaloacetate, ammonia aspartate or ammonia glutamate. So in the first reaction, the first nitrogen atom of urea is contributed by ammonia itself, and in the third reaction, the second nitrogen atom of urea is gained by this aspartate. So the answer is ammonia aspartate, that is C. The number of high energy phosphates used in the formation of one molecule of urea is 1, 2, 3 or 4. So we know that in the first reaction, 2 ATP are utilized, and in the third reaction, 1 ATP molecule is cleaved into AMP and pyrophosphate, but further that pyrophosphate is cleaved into 2 molecules of inorganic phosphate, which is equivalent to 2 high energy phosphate bonds, and that's why one molecule of urea synthesis requires 4 high energy phosphate bond, and that's why the answer is option D. The amino acid that is continuously regenerated and recycled in the urea cycle is it citrulline, arginine, ornithine or aspartate? So we know that ornithine, which is present in the cytosol, it is transported in the mitochondria and utilized in the second reaction for synthesis of citrulline. Again, citrulline comes back in the cytosol and undergoes reaction 3, 4 and 5, and the ornithine is regenerated, which again goes into mitochondria for the second reaction. So ornithine is the amino acid which is continuously regenerated and recycled in the urea cycle. The enzyme of urea cycle which is exclusively present in the liver is it ornithine transcarbamoylase, arginosuccinate synthetase, arginosuccinase or arginase. This urea cycle or urea formation occurs exclusively in the liver because the enzyme arginase is present only in the liver. Up to synthesis of arginine, all other enzymes can be present in any other cell, but as the synthesis of urea requires arginase and this arginase is present exclusively in the liver, that's why urea formation occurs only in the liver. So here the answer is arginase. Next question is, the metabolite released in the urea cycle that enters TCA cycle is it succinate, fumarate, citrate or oxaloacetate? So we know that in the fourth reaction, fumarate is released, and this fumarate forms the linkage between urea cycle and TCA cycle, and this fumarate is converted into malate, and then malate is converted into oxaloacetate. So that's why the metabolite is, answer is fumarate. The amino acid of urea cycle that serve as precursor of polyamines is it ornithine, citrulline, arginosuccinate or arginine? So it is ornithine, because this ornithine is required for synthesis of polyamines. And the last question is, the metabolite of TCA cycle on transamination produces an amino acid that takes part in urea cycle is it succinate, malate, alpha ketoglutarate or oxaloacetate? So here, that metabolite of TCA cycle is oxaloacetate, which is transaminated to form aspartate, and then later on that aspartate is utilized in the urea cycle in reaction number 3 to form arginosuccinate. If you find this video useful, please subscribe, like and share, and thank you for watching.